Caribbean.
You Can Still Get That? Tropical Diseases and the Traveller by Marty McCafferty and Nick Bird. Part of the allure of diving travel is the opportunity to enjoy unique environments both above and below the water. Exotic locations entice us with vivid beauty, but may also harbor unique health risks. Dan's medical department is often asked to provide information on various travel-related ailments, and this podcast provides an overview of some of the topics about which we are asked most frequently. For residents of many developed countries, the diseases and plagues of history are distant memories, far removed from our current consciousness. Advances in medicine and public health have either eradicated or minimized the impact of many diseases that used to claim countless lives. But the stark reality is that such diseases are still very real in many parts of the world, and some are spreading to areas that previously enjoyed sanctuary. Fortunately, most of the more serious diseases are preventable. Do some research before your trip. Travel health begins at home. There are several resources of reliable, up-to-date, and readily available information for travelers, including the websites of the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, CDC, the World Health Organization, WHO, and for DAN members, World Q Planner. DAN defers to these resources for answers to questions about disease prevention and potential health risks faced by travelers. Vaccinations. Preventing disease transmission and infection is one of the most powerful health-preserving techniques available. In addition to staying in good shape, getting sufficient sleep, and maintaining adequate nutrition and hydration, vaccines are a critical step for protection against many diseases that have no specific treatment. Make sure your vaccinations are current, and ask your doctor if particular boosters or vaccinations are recommended for the area you will be visiting. Among the most commonly recommended vaccines are those for hepatitis A and B, and the combination booster for diphtheria, tetanus, and pertussis. Others include polio and varicella. If you can't remember when or if you received these immunizations, your doctor can test the antibody levels in your blood to confirm sufficient immunity, as some of these vaccinations may require a series of injections. It is a good idea to talk to your doctor well before you travel. Rabies. Rabies is a viral disease affecting the central nervous system and is most often transmitted through infected saliva from a dog or wild animal bite. Nearly all cases of infection are fatal to those without immunization. Post-exposure vaccinations are effective for preventing rabies if they are administered before symptoms develop. Initial symptoms may last for days following a bite, are similar to flu, and include generalized weakness, fever, and headache. Symptoms then progress from anxiety, confusion, and agitation to delirium, hallucinations, insomnia, paralysis, difficulty swallowing, and hypersalivation. Death usually occurs within days of these symptoms. The CDC recommends avoidance of wild or unknown animals such as dogs, cats, raccoons, skunks, ferrets, foxes, monkeys, and bats. If contact with any of these animals is possible, consider getting vaccinated. Rabies vaccination consists of 3 shots administered over 4 weeks. Even if you receive pre-exposure vaccination, you will still need immediate medical treatment if you are bitten or scratched by an animal that is a potential carrier. Food and drink considerations. Operators of resorts and large hotels work to ensure the well-being of their guests. It is in their best interest to maintain a safe and healthy environment. In circumstances where you are not confident in the safety of food, consider the adage, boil it, cook it, peel it, or forget it. Hot and steaming is safe, as is fruit if it is freshly peeled by the consumer. Bread is safe too, but avoid buffets, room temperature foods, previously peeled fruit, raw produce, and salads. Also avoid raw and insufficiently cooked seafood and milk products unless they are boiled or pasteurized. Tap water at resorts is usually safe to drink, but do not hesitate to ask about the water supply and purification process before using it. Venturing outside resorts increases uncertainty. The source of the water may not be known, and its potability may be suspect. Factory sealed bottled water is safe, as are other sealed beverages. Filling water bottles or obtaining bottled water from resorts before exploring is a good idea in some areas. If you have any doubt whether a water bottle you bought is truly sealed, don't drink it. Ice is also suspect, especially if you are uncertain of the water source. Ciguatera. The risk of many foodborne pathogens, such as Salmonella, E. coli, or Scombroid, can be minimized by following safe handling guidelines, but there are exceptions to this rule, and Ciguatera is one of them. Ciguatoxin is originally produced by dinoflagellates, that are minute marine organisms eaten by herbivorous fishes. These are then in turn eaten by larger predatory fish, such as jacks, barracuda, snapper, and groupers. What makes this toxin different is that it is heat stable, which means cooking does not break it down. Symptoms of Ciguatera typically occur within 6 to 12 hours of ingestion and include nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, and numbness or tingling of the lips and skin around the mouth. The numbness and tingling can spread to the extremities. There may even be a reversal of hot and cold sensations. This toxin is not generally life-threatening, but there have been exceptions. Symptoms of Ciguatera have been mistaken for decompression sickness, but hyperbaric treatment has no effect. Care is supportive, and symptoms usually resolve within a few days or weeks. The best resource for knowing what fish are safe to eat is local residents, so don't be afraid to ask. Traveler's diarrhea. Despite our best efforts at prevention, traveler's diarrhea may strike. It can usually be managed without professional medical care, but it is important to know when to seek care and not to wait too long before doing so. The following points should be used as guidelines for when to seek assistance. Diarrhea with accompanying abdominal pain that lasts for more than 12 hours. Diarrhea with fever of 38 degrees or higher. Pain that is localized to a specific area of the abdomen. Unusual tenderness or hardness of the abdomen. Signs of shock, which may include dizziness, rapid breathing, rapid pulse, sweating, or anxiety. Blood in the stool or urine. Even if none of these serious warning signs are present, anyone who has diarrhea for 24 hours or longer should seek medical treatment. Fluid loss may surpass the individual's ability to replace the loss solely by drinking. Over-the-counter medications to minimize diarrhea are often used and may decrease discomfort. These should not be used for more than a day or two. They are better considered as temporary relief than a definitive solution. Antibiotics may also be prescribed for traveler's diarrhea and can speed resolution. Wounds. High heat and humidity, endemic pathogens, and varying levels of sanitation mean some tropical environments present a higher risk for infection of wounds. Immediate, thorough cleansing is important once any bleeding is under control. Irrigate the wound with water clean enough to drink and remove debris and help flush out pathogens. Wash around the wound with soap. The same soap you'd use at home is fine. consider application of topical antibiotic ointment and sterile dressing. It's important to keep the wound as clean and dry as possible. Repeat this process every day until the wound is closed. Any redness, fever, increasing drainage, or pain should prompt medical attention. The best defense against disease is maintenance of good health. Routine hygiene, a healthy diet, and regular exercise are essential. Knowing what diseases you are likely to encounter will provide direction for preventative measures and help guide your choices when it comes to eating and drinking, excursions and activities. With proper planning and preventative strategies, your travels can be rewarding and uncomplicated. There are several mosquito-borne diseases, of which malaria and dengue fever are the most important. Malaria is discussed in detail in another podcast, and we refer you to that. In this podcast, we'll only be considering dengue fever, but the recommendations regarding avoidance of mosquito bites applies to both. Dengue fever is a mosquito-borne disease. It is transmitted by several species of the genus Aedes. The incidence and geographic spread of the viral infection is increasing. The mosquito species that spread dengue include Aedes aegypti and albopictus. Unique features of these mosquitoes are that they live and breed in proximity to human dwellings and are low-level flyers. According to the World Health Organization, dengue is the most prevalent, worldwide, mosquito-borne viral disease, with more than 50 million infections estimated every year. The initial infection may go unnoticed, or it may appear as flu-like symptoms. Individuals who experience no symptoms or mild, unremarkable symptoms may become carriers who enable international spread. Clinical manifestations of the disease typically occur within 4 to 6 days of being bitten. These symptoms may include sudden onset of chills, fever, severe headaches, and intense muscle and joint aches, often referred to as break bone fever. Other symptoms may include abdominal pain, vomiting, and in children, a cough. The symptoms last typically about a week, and some patients experience sudden temperature drops known as saddleback fever during the 3rd or 4th day. Of particular concern is the more severe form of dengue fever known as dengue hemorrhagic fever. As the name suggests, clinical signs include bleeding, bruising, blood in the urine and stool, rash, and profound shock. This form of disease results from repeat infection when the antibodies from the initial response are still present. Therefore, it's most often seen in endemic areas, in other words, areas in which the disease is known to exist, and in infants within whom maternal antibodies are still present. Diagnosis of dengue is largely based on clinical presentation and is more likely in endemic areas where clinicians see the condition frequently. People who present to emergency rooms or primary care officers who neglect to talk about recent travel may go undiagnosed. As this is a viral infection, treatment is supportive, in other words, intended to relieve symptoms. Consisting primarily of fluids and pain medications, this treatment is not curative. An elevated clinical suspicion may enable more focused evaluation and also preclude a lot of unnecessary testing. Such insight may also enable more appropriate surveillance and more rapid response in the event of symptoms worsening. Preventing mosquito bites. An important component of preventing dengue and malaria lies in reducing the risk of being bitten by mosquitoes. Use of protective clothing, such as long sleeves, pants, and closed-toe shoes, and DEET can all minimize exposure. There's no evidence that products containing more than 50% DEET are any more effective. Window screens, and removal of freestanding water in areas around your home will keep living spaces safer and decrease breeding opportunities. With regard to dengue fever, Aedes mosquitoes can't fly higher than a few feet, so use of elevated beds with mosquito screens are additional strategies with demonstrated effectiveness. These precautions also reduce the risk of bites and stings by other insects that are not as worrisome as mosquitoes are, but can nonetheless make a vacation less enjoyable. You have been listening to You Can Still Get That? Tropical Diseases and the Traveller by Marty McCafferty and Nick Bird. Please note that the section on malaria was deliberately excluded and is dealt with exhaustively on another podcast. We refer you to that.